Keep calm. That was a message my heart needed when I heard the news that the stay-at-home mandate had been extended through the end of May. I had been hoping that perhaps by the middle of May we might be able to be together once again on Sunday mornings. It's beginning to feel a little bit like our worship gatherings are the proverbial carrot on a stick, which is always just beyond our reach. So I've had to remind myself, as perhaps you have had to remind yourself, to keep calm. That is the message of Isaiah 40, which we have been unpacking over the past several weeks. By way of reminder, Isaiah's words have encouraged us to keep calm because God has a plan for his people. And he tells us to keep calm because God has made promises to his people. And God always keeps his promises. And Isaiah reminds us to keep calm because of the kind of God he is, by the character of God, who is great and who is good. This morning we are reminded that we can keep calm because of the grandeur, the magnificence, the impressiveness, the splendor of God. Isaiah draws our attention to God's grandeur beginning in verse 12 and continuing on through verse 26. If you have your Bibles, and I hope you do have them in front of you this morning, I invite you to follow along as I read that passage. Isaiah 40, beginning in verse 12. Who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand, or with the breadth of his hand marked off the heavens? Who has held the dust of the earth in a basket, or weighed the mountains on the scales and the hills in a balance? Who has understood the mind of the Lord or instructed him as his counselor? Whom did the Lord consult to enlighten him, and who taught him the right way? Who was it that taught him knowledge or showed him the path of understanding? Surely the nations are like a drop in a bucket. They are regarded as dust on the scales. He weighs the islands as though they were fine dust. Lebanon is not sufficient for altar fires, nor its animals enough for burnt offerings. Before him, all the nations are nothing. They are regarded by him as worthless and less than nothing. To whom, then, will you compare God? What image will you compare him to? As for an idol, a craftsman casts it, and the goldsmith overlays it with gold and fashions silver chains for it. A man too poor to present such an offering selects wood that will not rot. He looks for a skilled craftsman to set up an idol that will not topple. Do you not know? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood since the earth was founded? He sits enthroned above the circle of the earth, and its people are like grasshoppers. He stretches out the heavens like a canopy and spreads them out like a tent to live in. He brings princes to naught and reduces the rulers of this world to nothing. No sooner are they planted, no sooner are they sown, no sooner do they take root in the ground than he blows on them and they wither, and the whirlwind sweeps them away like chaff. To whom will you compare me? Or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift your eyes and look to the heavens. Who created all these? He who brings out the starry host one by one and calls them each by name. Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of them is missing. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. Would you pray with me as we approach it this morning? Father, we thank you for your word. Father, we thank you that it is truth. Father, we thank you that according to your word, you always accomplish the purpose. Your word always accomplishes the purpose for which you send it. Father, you are sending it into our minds, into our hearts this day for a purpose, for a reason. Father, we pray and we thank you that that purpose will be accomplished. Father, may we in the pages of your word this day see your grandeur. And Father, may we respond to it in ways which are appropriate. Father, nourish us, feed us, lead us in these moments. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. While I was in college, I was introduced to the work of the photographer Ansel Adams. Adams' medium was black and white photography, and his preferred subject matter was the Sierra Nevada mountain range. The mountain range nestled between the eastern border of California and the western border of Nevada. This mountain range includes Yosemite National Park. Adams' work captured the grandeur, the magnificence, the splendor of the scenery, and the images which he produced led in large part to the formation of both Sequoia National Park and Kings Canyon National Park back in the 1940s. In addition, Adams' work helped to forestall the over-commercialization and development within Yosemite National Park itself, so that its pristine beauty would be preserved. All this is to say that decisions were made, plans were set in place, and in some cases, plans were altered by Adams' images, by his pictures. Here's a case where the adage, a picture is worth a thousand words, proved to be true. A phrase, by the way, accredited to a guy in marketing. Images, pictures, they lead us in many cases to the decisions and the choices that we make. In Isaiah chapter 40, God is using his spokesperson, his prophet Isaiah, to help, in a sense, to help us, the reader, gain a picture of God. A picture, an image that will capture the grandeur, the magnificence, the impressiveness, the splendor of God. But his medium of choice was not canvas or film or pixels, since none of those were available to him for the task in his day. So Isaiah was left to capture the grandeur of God through the medium of language and words. Isaiah's verbal portrait of God begins in earnest at the end of verse 9, where he writes, "Here is your God." What follows, as we saw last week, is the representation of God's greatness and the representation of God's goodness. He is a conqueror. Israel's God is a shepherd. With his arm, he crushes the enemies of God's people. And with that same arm, we saw, he cradles his people and cares for them. That picture was painted by Isaiah to answer a question which was on the minds of God's people. After all we've done, does God still care about us? After all of our rebellion against him, after his promise of judgment upon us, will he in fact deliver us? The verbal picture which Isaiah paints in verses 9 through 11 offers a resounding and a reassuring yes to God's people. But there was apparently and evidently a question that continued to linger in their minds. Even if God does care about us, even if he has not given up on us, is he able to do anything for us? Can he, in fact, deliver us? It's this latter question that is addressed by Isaiah in verses 12 through 26. Here Isaiah paints a picture of the grandeur of God, which is intended to answer their question with a resounding, yes, God can. Which leads us here, God's children can keep calm in all circumstances, even in the COVID-19 circumstances, which we find ourselves in. We can keep calm when we are reminded of the grandeur of God. In verses 12 through 26, Isaiah helps us to catch a glimpse of his grandeur as he paints his verbal picture of God for for us. Let's take a look at that this morning. And the first thing that we notice from Isaiah's words is this: God's grandeur is seen through his creation and through his wisdom. Verse 12 asks a series of questions, rhetorical in nature, that point us to God's activity in creation and his superiority over creation. The text reads, "Who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand? Or with the breadth of his hand marked off the heavens? Who has held the dust of the earth in the basket or weighed the mountains on a scale and the hills in the balance?" The answer harkens back to verses 9 and 10 where Isaiah says, "Here is your God. Behold, the sovereign Lord comes. Behold, Adonai, Yahweh. He is the one. He has measured. He has marked off. He has held. He has weighed. He and no one else. He alone and no other supposed God has done this." Adonai Yahweh, he is unique in his relationship to creation. He is not a part of the created order. He is above and superior to the created order by virtue of being all of creation's creator. The grandeur of God, of Israel's God, of Adonai Yahweh, is seen in his creation, but also in his wisdom. As Isaiah continues, "Who has understood the mind of the Lord or instructed him as his counselor? Whom did the Lord consult or enlighten him, and who taught him the right way? Who was it that taught him knowledge or showed him the path of understanding?" Who was Adonai Yahweh's teacher? For many aspects of life, it recently occurred to me, I have a guy. Actually, I have multiple guys or people who fill in the gaps of my knowledge, who fill in the gaps of my skill set, who fill in the gaps of my energy level. So I have a lawn care guy who keeps the weeds out of my yard and keeps the grass lush and green. And I have a car guy who keeps my vehicles running smoothly and fixes them when they don't run smoothly. And I have a retirement fund guy who helps me to make decisions about where to invest my retirement funds. And I have a health and well-being guy who helps me get better when I'm sick or injured. So you get the idea. I have my guys, my people that I can turn to. And you likely have your own set of people, your own guys to turn to. So who was Adonai Yahweh's guy? Who was his go-to guy? Who does Adonai Yahweh turn to in order to fill in the gaps of his knowledge? Whose skill set does Adonai Yahweh rely on when his skill set is insufficient? Whose power does he turn to when the job is too big for him? The truth? God has no guy. God needs no guy to fill in the gaps of his knowledge, the gaps of his skill, the gaps of his power. God's wisdom is such that he doesn't need to turn to any expert in any field because he is the expert in every field. He is the maker of every field. He will never fall prey to bad advice because he doesn't just think he knows everything. We know people like that. But he does know everything. Adonai Yahweh is the creator of everything, and he knows everything there is to know about everything he has created. God's grandeur is seen in the uniqueness of his relationship to creation and to the fullness of his wisdom. So God's grandeur is seen through his creation and through his wisdom. But also Isaiah tells us that God's grandeur surpasses that of the nations and their false gods. In order to add to his verbal depiction, his verbal picture of God's grandeur, Isaiah leaves behind his use of the rhetorical question and takes up the brush of flat assertion. He shares some things about God directly. Isaiah continues, "Surely, in fact, the nations are like a drop in a bucket. They are regarded as dust on the scales." The nations, they are, in the words of Isaiah, insignificant. When dust falls upon a scale that's being used to weigh something, you don't bother to brush the dust off because it has no weight or substance to it. Surely the nations are like a drop in a bucket. They are regarded as dust on the scales, inconsequential. He weighs the islands there meaning nations. He weighs the islands as though they were fine dust. For example, as wealthy and as prosperous as Lebanon is not sufficient for altar fires, nor its animals enough for burnt offerings. Nothing in Lebanon is enough, is sufficient to rightly honor Adonai Yahweh. Before him, all the nations are as nothing. They are regarded by him as worthless and less than nothing. Less than nothing, literally, that which is not. He regards the nation as that which is not, as that which does not exist, as that which is empty. He regards the nation as that which has no substance. Now, this isn't a knock on the nations. You could form the impression from these words that God despises the people of every nation but his own. But that would be to draw a wrong conclusion. God created all the nations of the earth and all the people of all the nations of the earth, and he has purposed to save and to claim them as his own people from every tribe and language and people and nation, people from every kindred, every tribe, as we have been reminded in our recent study of Luke's gospel. Here Isaiah is asserting that all the nations and all the kings of all the nations, with all their pride and their boastfulness and their power, when stacked beside Adonai Yahweh, they are nothing in comparison to him. His grandeur surpasses any claim to grandeur made by any one of these. In verse 18, Isaiah returns to the rhetorical question. To whom then will you compare God? What image, what idol will you compare him to? The grandeur of the nations falls short. How about the gods of the nations? Do they compare with Adonai Yahweh? In Isaiah's words, we hear that tone. What? Are you kidding me? Of course they don't compare to him. I can hear my high school social studies teacher, Mr. Sachs, "You've got to be kidding me." As for an idol, you would compare its grandeur and glory to Adonai Yahweh's grandeur and glory? As for an idol, a craftsman casts it, and the goldsmith overlays it with gold. It almost sounds here like an assembly line. You do your job to make this God, and I'll do my job to make this God, and it'll all come together. As for an idol, a craftsman casts it, and a goldsmith overlays it with gold and fashions silver chains for it. Question, why does an idol need silver chains? Is this some bling to make it pop? Actually, these chains were intended to hold it upright. It would not be prudent to let your God fall over now, would it, when you're worshiping? Wouldn't be a good picture. So chains are fashioned to hold it in place. A man, as Isaiah continues, a man too poor to present such an offering. If you can't afford a gold idol, if you can't come up with the funds for that, a man too poor to present such an offering, an idol of gold, selects wood that will not rot. You can't have your God rotting now, can you? That wouldn't do. And you have to watch out for termites. So you have to pick your wood appropriately. He looks for a skilled craftsman to set up an idol that will not topple. And when they're done, they think they have something, something worthy of their worship and honor and praise. No. Adonai Yahweh's grandeur far surpasses any glory or grandeur that humans may attribute to their nations or to the kings of their nations or to the gods of their nations. It's not even close. It's comical to even consider. God's grandeur surpasses that, far surpasses that of the nations and other gods. Finally, Isaiah, as he continues to take his verbal paintbrush in hand, he shows us this and tells us this, reminds us of this. God's grandeur is settled by his sovereignty and strength. Isaiah continues, "Do you not know? Have you not heard?" In these words, it's possible to hear echoes of Isaiah chapter 6, verses 9 and 10, where God commissions Isaiah as his spokesman. And with these words, with these instructions, "Isaiah, go and tell this people, be ever hearing, but never understanding. Be ever seeing, but never perceiving." The question was, and what God was telling Isaiah, is there are going to be among my very own people those whose hearts are so calloused by their sin and so rebellious against me, their God, that they will lose sight of my grandeur and my glory in spite of every advantage they have enjoyed as my people. Do you not know? Do you, my people, not know? Have you, my people, not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood this since the earth was founded? The reality of these questions is to bring forth this response. You do know this. You have heard this. From your earliest days, God has revealed himself to you. Of course you know this. This is Sabbath School 101. You know this. And what they have known, and that which was not hidden from them, points to God's sovereignty over all creation, to his being Adonai, the master of all creation. Isaiah continues, he sits enthroned above the circle of the earth. He is not a part of creation. He is above it and superior to it. He is the creator, not a created being. And its people, the people of the earth, are like grasshoppers by comparison. He stretches out the heavens like a canopy and spreads them out like a tent to live in. He brings princes to naught and reduces the rulers of this world to nothing. No sooner are they planted, no sooner are they sown, no sooner do they take root in the ground, no sooner do the nations of the earth are they planted, no sooner do they begin to grow, than God blows on them and they wither and a whirlwind sweeps them away like chaff. God's grandeur is seen in his sovereignty over all creation and over all the affairs of man. This is a theme which Isaiah has struck again and again with the hammer strokes of his words in order to leave an impression upon the hardened hearts of God's people. He is sovereign. So why are you following? Why are you pursuing? Why are you worshiping other gods? The text continues, "To whom will you compare me?" Now I love this. God seems to have brushed Isaiah aside for the moment, as though God had been sitting in the corner, close at hand, listening to everything that Isaiah had to say. But now he can't help himself. God cannot remain silent. And so he's no longer speaking through the prophet. Now God speaks directly for himself. To whom will you compare me? To whom will you compare me? Or who is my equal, says the Holy One. Here is yet another title of Israel's God. Here is a title placed alongside that of Adonai, Yahweh, the Holy One. The word holy, this title speaks of the otherness of God. The word holy, as we have seen so often, at its very root means to be other or different. For something to be holy means that it is unique in every way, one of a kind. And such is the case of Israel's God. He is different in essence. He is above creation. He is different in character, perfectly moral, always doing what is right. Lift up your eyes and look to the heavens. Who created all these? He who brings out the starry host one by one and calls them each by name. Because of his great powers and mighty strength, not one of them is missing. Each and every one of the heavenly bodies that he has created, that he has named, they are exactly where God intended them to be. So do not worship those things, God is saying, that I've set in place. Worship the one who set them in place. Sometime back in a daily devotional, Our Daily Bread, I ran across these words. The universe is astoundingly grand. There's a lot of grandeur in the universe. It's pretty impressive. Right now, the moon is spinning around us at nearly 2,300 miles an hour. Our earth is spinning around the sun at 66,000 miles an hour. Our sun is one of 200 billion other stars and trillions more planets in the galaxy. And that galaxy is just one of 100 billion other galaxies hurtling through space. Astounding. In comparison to this vast cosmos, our little earth is no bigger than a pebble, and our individual lives no greater than a grain of sand. Yet according to Scripture, the God of the galaxies attends to each microscopic one of us in intimate detail. Is there any question regarding God's grandeur and glory? Oh, may it be settled for each one of us as we see afresh the sovereignty and the strength of our Creator God. Well, Isaiah has used all the words and all the imagery at his disposal to paint for us a picture of God's grandeur. A picture of God's magnificence, of his splendor, of his otherness. But remember Ansel Adams' photographs. They were not photographs taken merely for the sake of information. This is what a mountain looks like. This is what a giant sequoia looks like. No, he made his images, he took his pictures in order to elicit a response, to set a course of action, to lead people to make decisions. And the same is true of the picture of God's grandeur which Isaiah has painted for us. He wasn't simply telling God's people. He's not simply telling us, this is what God is like. Here's your God. No, he has painted his picture in order to elicit a response from God's people. Isaiah has painted his picture in order to elicit a response from us, to lead us to decisions and choices. Well, what might those decisions and choices be that Isaiah has in mind? What does he want us to do in response to the picture that he has repainted of God's glory and of God's grandeur? I think three things Isaiah has in mind. Isaiah intends that the picture that he has painted of God's grandeur will lead each and every one of us to worship. He has painted this picture in order to elicit before God a response of humility and surrender to Him. If you've seen the grandeur of God, if you have, I cannot help but believe that you are drawn to worship one such as this. But likewise, secondly, the picture of God's grandeur, which is painted here by Isaiah, it is intended to lead us to listen and pay attention to what God has to say. One like this, a God like this, has something worth hearing. A God like this demands a hearing. And it demands obedience. Isaiah's verbal paintbrush, the picture that he has painted, he intends for it to lead us to listening and obeying God. Thirdly, the picture of God's grandeur was intended to lead us to trust in God and to keep calm. To keep calm in the face of and in the midst of days such as these. The picture which Isaiah has painted of God, of our Creator, of our Heavenly Father, who is the Father of all who trust in Christ. The picture which Isaiah has painted of God is one of God on the throne. He is the one who is Creator. He is the one who is all-knowing. He is the one who is incomparable. He is the one who is wholly other and different from all other gods. He is the one who is sovereign, and He is the one who is strong, and He is the one who loves and cares for His child. Oh, may we cast our gaze upon Him. And as we do so, as we fix our eyes upon Him, I believe we will stay calm and keep calm. I believe that as we fix our eyes on Him, as we fix our eyes upon the grandeur of God, we can keep calm even in days like these. I pray that the grandeur of God is not dimmed in our minds or in our hearts. And I pray that the grandeur of God is not diluted in any way during these days. Oh, but I trust that we will continue to see His glory, to experience His power, His grace, His goodness, and His greatness. Oh, may we behold His glory and His grandeur, that our hearts may be calm, and that our joy may be full. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank You so much for Your word. We thank You for the picture which Isaiah has painted for us. Father, there are many claims to glory and grandeur in our world. But Father, none surpasses You. Father, we would ask that You would fill our hearts with a picture of who You are. And Father, may that picture, may the reality behind that picture, Father, fill us with great peace and great joy in these days. Father, to that end, we ask that Your Spirit would keep ever before us the reality of who you are. Father, may your Spirit constantly remind us, constantly speak to us, constantly tell us, here is your God. He is Adonai Yahweh, the Holy. And Father, in those realities, may we find peace. For this we ask, in Jesus' name.
How great is our